Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. It's good to have you here today, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on announcements. I kind of want to go into our call to worship for today, and I'm going to start right here, and this is what it's all about. This is from Matthew chapter 28, starting at verse 1. Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his garment was as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. And the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying, and quickly go and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." And they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to report it to the disciples. Never get tired of hearing that. It's such a wonderful story. And it's the reason we're here today. It's the reason when you're driving in, you got to see the full moon and just in God's wonder and awe. And this is kind of a reminder I want to give you from this. This is from Max Lucado. And you know, everybody knows I like to quote Max and some of the things that he comes up with. The death of Jesus Christ was God's plan, not just for the salvation of the world, but for the salvation of you as well. That is the heart of the gospel. The Bible says we have fallen short of God's perfect standard. We all deserve God's eternal judgment. But Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In some inexplicable way, Jesus hung on the cross. He took the punishment, the wrath of God, that you and I deserve. And if that doesn't get your blood stirring in the morning and get you excited about what God has in store for you, nothing will. It's so good to be here today. I look forward to sharing with you later in the service.
Let's stand together this morning as we sing out praises to God.
Open paradise.
Kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing. You would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing. You would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. Is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Darkness, a battle in the grave.
Everybody has had a blessed week, and we have many prayer concerns and praises today. As we know, as we go through life, there's many trials that come along, but there's also many praises that come along. There's a couple, you can see them in the bulletin, but there's a couple of additional ones that are not in there. Terry Hostetler is having knee surgery soon. We need to remember him. Jeannie Beakley is having a heart procedure soon.
Couple weeks.
We need to remember her. Gary's with us today. How you doing, Gary? Good to have you here. We've been praying for you. Saw him last week at Tim and Jan's celebration, so we had a good time sharing at that. So it's always good to see when God allows us to get out and around and can come in fellowship, especially on a morning like today. And again, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Just want to spend a little time in prayer before Mike comes to sing and Pastor Dave comes with his message for today. It's been a wonderful week. I hope you guys have seen that. In spite of everything that's going on in the world around us, God has blessed us and we have a lot to be thankful for. And I kind of want to remember, I want to leave that with you as we enter into our time of prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today in the quietness of the earlier morning today. It's always wonderful to hear the birds singing and to see the sun shining, to see the full moon as we were driving in. All these things you have made. You have blessed us with a wonderful place to live until you call us home and we're all together for eternity, Lord. Just so excited about what you have in store for us in the days and months ahead. May we all be open in our hearts to doing whatever you would have us do, Lord. Lord, we have many people that are afflicted with illness or any number of things in their lives, Lord, and we want to lift some of those up for today. We want to lift them all up, but specifically Terry Hostetler and his knee surgery coming up, and Jeannie Beakley and her heart procedure that's coming up in a few weeks. Lord, continue to bless Charlie and Linda Beakley during these times of trial with Charlie's dementia and the things that he's been going through. Just be with that family and lift them up, and know that life doesn't end here on earth. We're going to be with you for an eternity, Lord, and that's the promise that we're all excited about, that we can do what we can do for you here on earth, but it's going to be a wonderful time in heaven when we all get to heaven, as Reverend Hamill used to say all the time. Lord, we just thank you for this congregation. We thank you for the people here today. May each and every one of us leave here with a new renewed vigor for what we have to do, Lord, and not only in our jobs and in support of our family, but Lord, and doing what we can for you and bringing others to know the knowledge of you, Lord, that we can all be together in eternity. We just love you and praise you, and thank you for this day. In your name we pray, amen.
I want to tell you about this special that Michael's going to sing for us today. It's an Andrew Peterson song called God Rested. And it takes the creation story where God created the world in 6 days and then he rested on the seventh. And it kind of equates that with Jesus, who on the seventh day went into the tomb and God rested. And that just struck me. How can God die and rest? And I started thinking about that. Let me tell you, I don't always look forward to Easter services because there's kind of a limited number of things you talk about on Easter. Usually it's the resurrection. And I've talked about that before. And it's like, how do you make it new for people who've heard the story? But I started thinking about God suffering and dying for us. And what does that mean? And can God suffer? And I can't tell you how deeply it touched me. And I wanted to share it with you. And so I wanted Michael to sing the song for us that kind of inspired me in that.
So they took his body down, the man who said he was the resurrection and the life was lifeless on the ground now. The sky was red, his blood along the blade of night. As the Sabbath fell, they shrouded him with linen. They dressed him like a wound. The rich men and the women, they laid him in the tomb. 6 days shall you labor, God rested. He said that it was finished, and the seventh day he blessed it. God rested. So they laid their hopes away. They buried all their dreams about the kingdom he proclaimed, and they sealed them in the grave. As the holy silence fell on all Jerusalem, but the Pharisees were restless. Thank you. sleep. But God rested. Shall you labor? The seventh is the Lord's. In six he made the earth and all the heavens, but he rested on the seventh. God rested. He worked till it was finished, and the seventh day he blessed it. He said that it was good, and the seventh day he blessed it. God rested. The sun went down, the Sabbath faded, the holy day was done, and all creation waited.
Thank you, Michael. Can God suffer, let alone die? The early church fathers said he couldn't. Actually, even before Christianity came to the West, Aristotle said that God was the prime mover. He was the one who moved the first cause, and he could not be moved. So therefore, God was the unmoved mover who could not be affected by this world. He could not suffer. And the early church fathers said that God was unchangeable and impassible. I've heard all sorts of theological descriptions of God. He's omnipotent, all-powerful. He's omniscient, all-knowing. He's omnipresent. He's all-present. I never even had heard of this word, impassible. Impassible is someone who is unable to suffer. And the early church fathers all believed that. Even in the Reformation, if you read the Westminster Confession of Faith, it explicitly says that God is without body, parts, or passions, immutable. So he is unchangeable, and he is unable to suffer. And I think there's a lot of reasons people thought this. I mean, God's so powerful, how could anything injure him? So if God can't be injured, how could he suffer? How could anything take anything away from God? And if it does, doesn't that diminish God? But I think there's four reasons people generally use today to describe why they say God can't suffer. But then I'm kind of questioning it now. I don't normally question 2,000 years of church theology, but can God suffer? Let's ask. One thing is, how can we matter that much to God, that God would care what we do? You know, when you love somebody and they turn their back on you, that hurts. That's maybe why we call an intense love passion, because there's so much potential there for suffering. But can God care about us that much that it matters to him what we do? Aristotle didn't think so. The early church fathers didn't think so. Today's passage is from Hebrews 2, 5 through 18. And the book of Hebrews quotes from the Old Testament, Psalm 8, a psalm of David, to talk about this. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking, but there is a place where someone has testified. And now he quotes David. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? A son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned them with glory and honor and put everything under their feet. David is saying, this great universe, you are a great God. How can you even care about people like us? I don't like this translation in NIV right here, because actually the original is singular. And I think they're trying to make it inclusive by... I think when David wrote it, he was saying mankind, men and women. But I think the author of Hebrews here is inspired by God to say there's something deeper here. When David says the son of man that you care for him, he may have just thought of just people, a son of man. But he used the term that Jesus used of himself, the son of man that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor. But David's asking that question. When I see everything you've made, why do you care about people like us? But then he says, but you do. You made us a little lower than the angels, crowned us with glory and honor. but he was also talking about Jesus. He goes on to say, in putting everything under them, God left nothing that is not subject to them. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to them, but we do see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Jesus is made perfect through what he suffered. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are from the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. He said, I will declare your name to my brothers and sisters. In the assembly, I will sing your praises. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, he says, here am I and the children God has given me. Since the children, that's you and me, have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For surely it was not angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. For this reason he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Because he entered into our humanity, and because he suffered, he's able to help us. And so we know without a doubt that Jesus suffered. It is amazing that God cares about us that much, but God does care about us that much. You know, when this theory about God being impassible really hit the rocks, where it really started foundering and sinking, World War I and World War II. When they opened up the concentration camps and when they found out that 6 million Jews and 4 million others had been killed in those camps and all the carnage of the war. And people started to say, does God care about what's happening to us? Look at what's happened to us. Does he even care? And some theologians said, yes, God suffers with us. Jürgen Moltmann was one of the main ones that kind of struck back on this. He said, a God who cannot suffer is poorer than any man, for a God who is incapable of suffering is a being who cannot be involved. Suffering and injustice do not affect him. And because he is so completely insensitive, he cannot be affected or shaken by anything. He cannot weep, for he has no tears. But the one who cannot suffer cannot love either. So he is a loveless being. Aristotle's God cannot love. He can only be loved by all non-divine beings by virtue of his perfection and beauty, and in this way draw them to him. The unmoved mover is a loveless beloved, and this is from his book, The Crucified God. Some of you know Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the Lutheran pastor in Nazi Germany, who stood up against Hitler and said, no, we will not support what you are doing in this country. And he was eventually executed by Hitler for that. He said, only a suffering God can help. That's from his letters from prison. He would write letters. He'd unfold the bottom of his toothpaste tube. He'd stuff the letter in the bottom of the tube, fold it back up again, and it would get out to the people outside the prison. But whether or not God can suffer, we can all agree on one thing, and that is that he loves. Because the Bible is very clear. Not only can God love, but he is love. And he loves us more than the world can ever know. Another question people have is, if God suffers, does that diminish him? And I've come to the conclusion that's not a good argument either, because an aloof God is not a greater God. Moltmann kind of talked about that, you know, that he is worse off than any person because he can't be involved. He can't care about others. You know, there's a comic book, The Watchmen. I guess it's not a great comic book, I don't know, but there's a character that was introduced in that called Dr. Manhattan. Just like most superheroes, he was made a superhero when he was blasted by some radiation, and it made him disappear. But then he appeared later as this glowing man, and he started getting all these great powers. And it's kind of interesting, the story arc, because the more powers he got, the more he started thinking, well, I can save the world, but why should I? He started thinking that human beings, in fact, all of the human race, the whole earth, really wasn't that big of a deal, and why should he even care about it? And I think that's kind of the picture that people have of the God who created this entire universe with 2 trillion galaxies that we know exist already, and probably many more than that. How could God care about us? And if he does suffer, does that make him less of a God? I'll tell you, I am not the most emotional person you've ever met, or at least I wasn't. Growing up, I think maybe I protected myself. I had 5 sisters. 5 sisters will make fun of you all day long. And so it was easy for me just to not say anything I really thought, just kind of be quiet about, you know, if I was going through any hard time, I'm not going to tell them. And I kind of practiced that, let's not be too emotional. And I remember we had this thing where we'd have youth teams called Crusader teams that would travel around churches for a summer. And you got to know these 6 or 10 people that you were with very, very well. And I remember at the banquet at the end, all these Crusaders were saying goodbye. They'd been together a whole summer, and they were crying and sobbing and hugging each other. And I was sitting there like, okay, all right. I'm like, I don't feel like crying. I thought, if I wanted to, I couldn't cry. You know, I just didn't feel like it. And I just thought, well, is something wrong with me? Everyone else is bawling their eyes out. And that really didn't change until I got married and had kids. And I remember at Jill's brother's funeral, you know, talking about David, crying the whole way through it and not even being worried about that. I remember dropping Jonathan off at college and just bawling because I'm so grateful to have a son like Jonathan, and how I was so proud of him and so happy. Happy tears, but also sad because we were going to be separated for a while. You know, my kids can move me to tears. My family can move me to tears. My friends, if I know that they're going through hard times, it can bring a tear to my eye. I can watch Encanto and have tears come down my face now. And I don't feel that I'm less for that. I'm glad for that because that means I care enough to be hurt by those people who are hurt. Is God less or is he more? Let me tell you, is this a God who suffers? Let me read you Isaiah 63:7-9. I will tell the kindnesses of the Lord, the deeds for which he is to be praised, according to all the Lord has done for us. Yes, the many good things he has done for Israel, according to his compassion and many kindnesses. He said, surely they are my people, children who will be true to me. And so he became their savior. In all their distress, he too was distressed, and the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. I'm not convinced yet that God is a God who is impassible, because if he is distressed in our distress, it sounds biblical that if he chooses to, he can suffer. Some people also have the question, the third thing is, God does not change, so how can he suffer? There are verses in the Bible that suggest God changes in some way. Let me read to you 1 Samuel 15:11. These are God's words. I regret that I have made Saul king, because he has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions. How can the God who knows the future, knows everything that will happen, regret something? It sounds like he changed his mind. And if so, doesn't God change? And I think that is not the whole story there, because the Bible does talk about God being angry at times, being regretful, grieving. There's other things that God is said that sounds like emotions, that he's changing his mind. I think that's just the Bible's way of describing to us something about God that we can only understand when it puts it in human terms. You understand God's eternal, and we may not be able to see the true picture of what God is like. And so they have to be putting it in human terms. That is how God looks at the moment. We went to see the Grand Canyon a few years ago, and we stopped and we could see the Grand Canyon. Then we got in the car and drove down the road, and we stopped and we saw the Grand Canyon again. It was different. There were different rock formations and all sorts of things. The Grand Canyon hadn't changed. We just went to a different spot and saw a different spot of it. That's the way I look at God. There may be times when God says, I'm regretting this. He knew he was going to regret it. We're just seeing him at a different time. We're seeing a different side of God. When we see his anger, we're seeing the holiness of God. When we see his grieving, we see the loving side of God and how he is affected by that. That was 1 Samuel 15:11, where it says, I regret making Saul king. But then just about 18 verses later, it says, he who is the glory of Israel does not lie or change his mind, for he is not a human being that he should change his mind. So God's not changing his mind. He's just saying, I pick Saul, but he's not 100% my character. There's a problem with Saul, and there's a reason for that problem. What I would say is, when we suffer and we see God who enters into our suffering, God hasn't changed at that moment. We are just seeing that side of God that we need right at that moment. We're seeing him in that suffering. I think the last argument people make is that God is self-sufficient, needing no one. So if God is self-sufficient, how can anything we ever do affect him? And the Bible does talk about this. He calls himself the I Am, the self-sufficient one. Psalm 50:12, he said, if I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine and all that is in it. I have no question that God has no need of us. If he chooses to, he could wipe us away, and he would be perfectly acceptable to do that, and he would go on living, and he would be okay. God does not need us, but he does want us. There are people who think that maybe if God doesn't take advantage of all of his rights and powers, that diminishes God. Some people say that, well, you can't make a decision about salvation. It's not your decision to make. God decides who goes to heaven and who goes to hell without any decision you make. I don't believe that. But many of them would say it diminishes God if you say he's not in control of that. And I would say, if God chooses to allow you to make a choice, that doesn't diminish his sovereignty or power. That just says God has chosen not to use his power in that case. And in the same way with suffering, what if God chooses to be vulnerable? What if God chooses to feel suffering and to be in our suffering? That doesn't diminish God, it magnifies him. It doesn't diminish God's power if he chooses to be vulnerable enough to love us. Have you ever read the book of Hosea? The prophet Hosea had a terrible marriage. His wife not only cheated on him, but cheated so much that eventually she became sold into slavery. And God said, hey, Hosea, go and buy your wife back. And he did. Can you imagine having to buy your wife back as a slave to set her free? Because she's been unfaithful. But he did. And God used Hosea's home life as an illustration of what he was facing with us and how we are unfaithful to him. And Hosea 11:1-9, you see the emotions of God. Let me read it to you. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. But the more they were called, the more they went away from me. They sacrificed to the Baals, and they burned incense to images. It was I who taught Ephraim to walk, taking them by the arms. But they did not realize it was I who healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with ties of love. To them I was like one who lifts a little child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them. That's God's description of his relationship with his people. I was like somebody who picks up a little child and holds him to his cheek. That's how I was to Israel, my people. Will they not return to Egypt? And will not Assyria rule over them because they refuse to repent? A sword will flash in their cities. It will devour their false prophets and put an end to their plans. My people are determined to turn from me. Even if they call on me, the Most High God, I will by no means exalt them. And then the very next verse. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? How can I treat you like Admah? How can I make you like Zeboim? Those are two cities that were destroyed along with Sodom and Gomorrah, by the way. How can I do it? My heart is changed within me. All my compassion is aroused. I will not carry out my fierce anger, nor will I devastate Ephraim again. For I am God and not a man, the Holy One among you. I'm not convinced that God doesn't suffer. I'm not convinced that God is untouched by our suffering. It seems to me, in every way that makes sense, when we suffer, God feels it. He chooses to. He could be invulnerable. I have no question about that. God can do anything he wants. But he chooses to enter into our suffering in that way. But whatever we think about this issue, we know that God suffered because God suffered in Christ. He came to be one of us, and all Christians believe that God suffered in Christ. When we have these Easter plays, we call them passion plays because they're a play about suffering, the suffering of Christ. This passage I read today from Hebrews says he was made perfect in suffering. That doesn't mean he wasn't perfect already. Remember, God's not a God of temporal life. This is part of his character that he was to suffer, and that was part of his perfection. Isaiah 53 says that he's a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Let me tell you, Jesus not only understands our suffering, he experienced it. Hebrews 4, 15 and 16 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." He said, we don't have a high priest who's unable to empathize with us. Jesus is our high priest who stands between us and God. And we have a high priest who can say to us, I've been there. And this was a way that they changed NIV too. This translation has changed. It used to be we don't have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us. And sympathy and empathy, as I understand the words, they used to be sort of meaning the same thing. But over time, it's changed now. Most people, when they say sympathy, they mean, I feel for you. You know, I haven't experienced it, but I feel sorry for what you're going through. And when they say empathy, they say, it means, I understand. I've been there. And I think it's so great that they changed that word, because that specifically is what happened. God already knows what suffering's about. He knows everything. But Jesus can say, I've been there. So when you get that diagnosis that says there's a terrible medical condition that you're dealing with, Jesus can say, I know what it's like. When you've lost a loved one, he knows what it's like. When someone betrays you, turns their back on you, he knows what that's like. When people falsely accuse you, he knows what that's like. When you're hungry, he knows that. When you're facing financial difficulties, he knows that. When you're overwhelmed with work and you don't know if you're going to be able to accomplish everything, he understands that, because he entered into our suffering. That's the whole reason he came, because this world is under a curse. We've got problems, people. Amen? And he came in on a rescue mission to enter into our suffering and then to die so that we could go to heaven and live forever. God suffered in Christ for us. Can God the Father suffer? I don't know. I'm not convinced it's impossible for him to suffer if he chooses to. But we know that Jesus suffered for us. And he is the image of the invisible God, the perfect representation of who God is, who cares enough about you to enter into your suffering with you and to provide comfort and ultimately perfect healing and solution. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this time together. And Lord, whatever is not worthwhile, whatever is not profitable, may we all forget it. But whatever words come from you, may they come to our soul, draw us closer to you. May we leave here with a deeper relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to close with a hymn, Because He Lives. Would you all stand with us? And I just want to encourage you, stay with us for breakfast. We're going to break the fast together and enjoy this Easter together. You again to stay with us. If you're able-bodied, you can have your admission to the breakfast be for taking one chair back there. So take it with you. Let's go ahead and close in prayer. Thank you, Father, for this time together. We thank you, Lord, that Christ is risen. Because we know that, we know that everything he said was true, that he suffered and died for us, and by his death we can live forever. Thank you, Father, with this reminder, and I pray, Lord, you'll go with us as we leave this place. Bless the food that we're about to eat, and bless the fellowship that we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Right now.